My wife would say that when I started trimming my beard up and trying to, like, shave my head on the regular, that it probably increased my status because I improved my looks.
And we are live with Captain Nate Wright today, talking about status. And, without much fluff, we can get in right into it. So I got this non-quote, but rather a paraphrasing from Naval Ravikant about status. Status is a zero-sum game. It's a very old game. We've been playing it since Monkey Tribe. It's a hierarchical, who's number one, who's number two. The problem with status game, you have to put somebody else down. And then he ends with, that's actually a quote, play stupid games, win stupid prizes. And basically that status, it's your ranking in social hierarchy. And then he kind of concludes that status games are always going to exist and that they are necessary evil. Question to you is, whether you think they are actually necessary, and are they actually evil?
Yeah, status games are necessary. There's three lenses to look at it through, right? Lens number one is the evolutionary status. Like, how did humans stay alive long enough to procreate, right? Lens number two is more sociological. How do you actually get other things done outside of, food and sex, which is the evolutionary game, right? How do you get other things, And in modern society, of course, on the sociological level, status sometimes comes with money or currency or some sort of tradable goods or tradable value. And that's already pretty well established. The final piece in the psychology piece, my theory, and I'll be honest, I don't have a lot of like hard scientific anecdotes to share on this, but in my experience, is not everyone wants to be on top. So I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing having someone go down in status. The assumptions being made there that they even want that spot. They want food and sex and money and clout and all those things, but in most social situations, and I'm talking, business and personal, that there are upsides and downsides to having status. Like on one far extreme, you look at celebrities and they sacrifice privacy. In other cases, some people, this is going to sound kind of asshole, they just don't. They don't possess the mental aptitude or the grit necessary to lead. Now, there is a big difference. There is a difference between high status and leadership. There are people that, when I was in the military, you called me Captain Wright. I haven't been called that since. That has been 15 About years.
50, yeah.
15. 15 years since I've been called that. And it's when I first became an officer, people had to call me sir, people had to salute me. I did get a commission, so it's a special piece of documentation signed by important people in the government saying that, there's a limited amount of people that commissions that are handed out each year. There's certain built-in status. It was not a renewable resource, on that particular week. in May of 2005 is when I pinned on Captain. And when I became an officer, though, it was the people that actually were the true leaders in one of the spheres of influence was the non-commissioned officers. That was the sergeants. I forget what they call them in the Navy, but you know, you got the bars and you got stripes. It's the basic delineation. Actually, in most countries, it's very interesting how that carried over cross culturally. But so there is a difference there. So, the short answer to your question is yes, I think it is necessary because there are certain people that don't want status. And there are certain people that are not equipped to be able to leverage and use statuses, frankly, on either an evolutionary scale or wrong place, wrong time. They don't know how to swim in those ponds. You know, and if you look at like a tribal mentality, it typically would require being strong and smart.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to...
Actually, strong, smart, and good looking. That's
what I wanted to say, that actually don't status games work best when they are based, and I think we are getting into like some Jordan Peterson discussions territory of like, don't status games inherently, weren't they based on competence? And the problem with them now oftentimes is that they are no longer, or the criticism of them is when they are no longer based on competence. Because I think if something is based on competence, so like how useful you basically are, then I think, you know, it makes sense that you are higher status. But if you are just playing some tricks to be on top, then the question becomes, you know, is that
well, the not data evil? Just doesn't support that. I mean, if you we'll look at some major things, right? We'll look at military, government, and business, right? Community, government, business. Those are three decent pillars, right?
Yeah.
In government, there are plenty of people that have status, and in the government, it's called a pay scale. You know, as a civilian or as a military member, and they have certain levels of powers that's granted with that. I challenge you to name one government where the person in charge is the most competent, right? So
yeah, that's the problem.
Competence with politics. Is not, I mean, yeah, I'll get political. Competence is not. Isn't necessarily rewarded.
Yeah.
It isn't rewarded. As I said, there's a difference between leadership and status. And I think that, you know, there's plenty of examples of people that grew status through smarts, like Talleyrand. I think that's how you pronounce his name. He was like French Revolution time frame. He survived and thrived from status and influence. He was able to make some pretty amazing things happen for a long time. He lived a long time. I think it was in the 70s or 80s when he died. And I don't know if he was good looking or not, but there are plenty of like anthropological studies and sociology studies and people hanging out in tribes and people looking at how babies look at things and all these different things. And frankly, promotions in business and promotions in the government and promotions in the military, you know, looks, it's not confidence. You just look better than other people. You're more visually pleasing to other people. Maybe it's disarming. Maybe it's lust, but that has nothing to do with competence. You just look better. Now, my wife would say that when I started trimming my beard up and trying to, like, you know, shave my head on the regular, that it probably increased my status because I improved my looks. I don't know if that's true or not.
But then the question is whether you actually care about it, right? Because, for example, I was listening to Sebastian Younger, who's got this book called, and I read this book as well, The Tribe on Homecoming and Belonging. It's really interesting. Mm-hmm. And he talks about the fact that people actually inherently love much more to be evaluated for their behavior rather than their status or wealth or money. And it shows up because he said that we evolved as egalitarian. And so, I don't know, it's all interesting. And also when you're talking about the politics, I think one thing from my side, at least, is that I think like politics is one of, especially in the times of peace, is the area that's, you know, the like the furthest away from this concept of like, you know, you being at the top means you being the most competent, when probably the closest still is like military, especially military during like war times. I think,
oh yeah,
I don't know, there's this thing, right? Like when there is something wrong, like war, mm-hmm. it requires more that the people at the top know what they're doing because the survival depends on it. And then when it's peace, it doesn't. So I think the kind of the split off happens, you know, when basically things are going well.
I mean, how would you split? Use that same model to split, like what would wartime and peacetime look like in business?
Yeah, that's, I think business is still pretty, like, we didn't talk about it, but you didn't talk about it, but I think from my perspective, business is still pretty damn close tied, still competence, like your level in business, because business is not so susceptible to like just theorizing and, you know, some idea bullshit. Like you in the end have to test it with reality, and then, you know, sometimes
either. Well, like if you look at competence, yeah, but if you look at wealth, you look at all the richest people, like you, like I'm not talking like if you remove the tech outliers, if you go further back in history, go back on, you know, who in their time was richest during other times, and you zoom out from the 20th and 21st century, it's old money. They were born into it. They were born into status. So the hierarchy we have now, that actually competence is even a heavily weighted part of the equation, is new. There are plenty of people and plenty of examples of folks that had a high competence for manipulation within their space. You know, I really think, but at its basic level, status, it is, you know, in the level of trust and likability and influence other people give you. That has nothing to do with you, and that's what I think muddies the water, because we are in the era of you. Or mindfulness is, I mean, a true story. Very easy story for me.
Are other stories not true?
I embellish sometimes. All the time. I went through some different, you know, therapies and, you know, cognitive behavioral therapy. My daughter has special needs, so I did 2 years of rigor, hundreds of hours of applied behavioral analysis, which is, I would consider, a different kind of therapy. I've studied, you know, acceptance and commitment therapy, ACT, which I think is fantastic. I've studied, you know, a little bit of Buddhism. I come, you know, my early years from the Christianity camp, and I've gone from the rock and roll churches all the way over to the Pentecostals to the Lutherans. I used to be a youth pastor, you know, so I'm keenly aware of the status inside of churches, which is one thing we haven't talked about yet, which is still a very powerful organizational structure and sociological structure. And then I've done, you know, the Headspace meditation. I've done, you know, I've got Untethered Soul behind me here, which is I was a super transformative book when I read it. Like, it really helped shift my thinking about how I saw myself, me, in the midst of the world and other people and relationships. And then fast forward to this year, and I picked up Sam Harris's thing, and I paid for a few months and went through, you know, a couple hundred hours of material there. And the reason that I left it, that I stopped meditating, is I felt, I stopped meditating via guided meditation in that particular approach, you know, mindfulness meditation in general, is that this, my self-awareness heightened. I was more aware of how I was behaving, but my awareness of others lessened. And it was actually had some negative impacts in relationship, and it created frustration, additional frustration, because I would blurt out what was in my head. And I spent so much time in my head throughout the day and really going deep, and, you know, I am the awareness and all the mantras that go with mindfulness meditation. And frankly, I was becoming, not, I don't want to say in a douchey way, I had been becoming kind of self-centered. And I've got a wife and a kid. And at a bare minimum, if that was the extent of my social circle, I needed to listen more and be more aware of them. Not, and this is where all the therapies I listed earlier are so important, not to make me feel better, just to be aware of their body language and their tone, and having a natural curiosity for what's going on with them, so that I could be a better, you know, husband and better father and better man and better boss and better mentee and better mentor, better interviewee. But I had become too detached from it. So I think when you like look at it through the, you know, the lens of status, the, in this particular era, you know, I'm in my 40s, so I'm relatively young, you know, I'm past the halfway mark for the average age of a man, just barely. This is where I'm supposed to be peaking right now, right? I hope not. but when you go further back with status, it's something that in certain cultures and certain societies and certain structures, these different structures like churches and militaries and companies, it has become empowering, because like now anyone could be a billionaire. Now anyone could be a pastor. Now anyone could become president. Right? And there are certain things that are limitations, like you, Arnold Schwarzenegger can't be the president of the US because there's laws in place that say you can't. You know, there are certain people that can't be in the military because they're too short or too tall. Or too dumb. That was almost me. I almost got kicked out multiple times in the military. I did not flourish there, and I was not a good soldier. So that's one of the reasons I don't talk about it that much anymore.
Because you need to love stuff
behind me. No plaques. There's no shadow case. I'm proud of surviving the military socially and emotionally, but I did not thrive in that status ranking. That's one of the reasons I left, honestly, was a little bit of fear that, you know, regardless of playing the game, which is what we called it, regardless of playing the game for promotions, because the higher you go up, the harder it gets. I had an opposite problem. I wasn't self-aware enough, and I just had this like distinct feeling that I wasn't smart enough or good looking enough or competent enough or strong enough or poised enough or manipulative enough to actually make rank. And there's a lot of other personal reasons that I left, you know, fatherhood being the biggest, but long answer to a short question, but
yeah. No, it's I don't know. It's super interesting because status is this. Yes, you said it's basically hierarchy. And for example, when I look at my life, it's just recently I realized that that's the reason I never fit in any of these places where there's like strong hierarchy, even though I always kind of had this thing to go in military, but I knew I would hate it because of the hierarchy. In school, I kind of never, you know, found myself because I would challenge the authority. And if you challenge it, you know, where you like, you are not liked and you are kicked out of it. So I always kind of, you know, not consciously kind of despised this kind of system of status. And I think in travel, I finally found that there is a different way. And now I'm starting to kind of understand that it all comes from this fact. And I think that ties to the Sebastian Younger that, like, inherently, I don't know if everyone has that, but for me, like, still the most important fact is, like, I don't really care who you are. I care about, like, what kind of person you are. Like under all of this, like, nothing really. And the same is for me. Like, I don't really care if you like all this stuff. Am I useful to other people? Am I a good person? Do I treat other human beings well? So that's why I think, you know, part of me thinks that maybe status, because I wanted to tie it back to finally business, is to ask you, like, is actually the path to, let's say, you know, becoming a person of, let's say, if you wanted to become a person of influence, mm-hmm. That's the path there require you to climb also the ladder of status? Or can you just become a person of influence through, like, you know, different means, you know what I mean? Because
that's an excellent question. Well, you and I talk about leverage a lot, you know, kind of the one of Andy Grove's favorite metaphors, you know, about high leverage. Status gives you an insanely long lever for influence. You're able to influence more. You could think of it like in physics as how much power and the length of the lever. There's so much that it does. However, status doesn't move that well. So if you earn status in a certain space, I can't shove that same crowbar into wood to open something up that I would use that crowbar to, say, peel a door off of a car. So it doesn't move that well. It doesn't travel well. And if you look at it in the business sense, it's much more tenuous. So in the military or government or church or anything like that, frankly, in families, if you look at like very large, like big Italian families or big Irish families, they, there is a certain either patriarchal or matriarchal like pecking order of who's in charge. India, how arranged marriages or sizes of family. I'm blessed by about an hour away from the Mexico border, and they have a different hierarchy. You know, they have different rules. And I'll be honest, like I wish business was more like that. However, even though business has a more tenuous social structure, you could lose your status. It's much easier. You could be number one, you know, you could be number one this year, like in boxing, like once someone challenges the title, you know, for me, I guess I would be one step below a heavyweight. It'd be like with the light heavyweight. If I was the light heavyweight champion, the second someone challenges my title and I either leave it unchallenged or I get my ass kicked, then I am no longer, I no longer have that high status. So it doesn't take much to get knocked from the top. But you mentioned before all the things you mentioned with that you care about how caring about other humans, are they useful, right? So there's a selfish thing and there's an altruistic piece. And for you, that is how you roll, right? That's how you think. That's how you move throughout the world. And it's if you could actually measure status by coming up with those criteria and weighting them, kind of doing kind of a Charlie Munger exercise where you assign a weight to different characteristics. You know, that's why all these personality things exist. But if you look at it like on an individual level, status is not about what I feel about myself. It's what other people, what value they assign me. So I could be the most competent, the best looking, the most useful person around, but that may not be recognized. Anyone that's ever worked on a group project, you know, in college or school knows this. That like, you know, sometimes a person that is the self-assigned group leader is, their ideas are dumb and you want to be heard, but you do not have the status to even be heard.
And he does have the humility, right? To hear this out or something like that.
Yeah, maybe people just don't like you. I don't think anyone had any opinion of me when I was in high school. And frankly, in business, I still encounter people like my status ladder that I've moved the highest up is email marketing. You know, I'm somewhere probably between the top 5 and top 20, maybe, you know, depending upon what characteristics you, how do you measure it? What's in, and that's the tough thing is that in business, the formula changes a lot. Like if I looked at volume of positive Upwork reviews multiplied by Trustpilot, multiplied by the email platforms, multiplied by podcast appearances, you know, exponentially based on the recency of all the stuff. Like if you like built a formula, you'd probably be able to say that in this space, Nate has X amount of status. Now, the second I move to say e-commerce, for example, I have an e-commerce business too, you know, a consulting business there, my status drops just because the formula changed. So on a personal level, I suppose that if I want to, and that's where it comes down to, Simon Sinek's, you know, the golden circle, right? You got the why and the why, how, and the what. Is that how it goes?
Man. Probably. Like that's the golden free question.
Yeah, no, so why. So if you add another circle to that, if you add the who as to another circle in, you know, Sinek's golden circle, you could ask the question, who do I want to influence? And if you map out who you want to influence, you could determine where you need to gain status. And it's typically more than one spot. And that's the mistake I think that I made myself and that I see other people make. Is they think of it as some one-dimensional thing. When the status, if you want to influence a certain group of people, and or even, hell, be liked by a certain group of people, it is not linear. It's not a line or a ladder.
I really want to connect two things there, because before you were also talking about like the self-development kind of thing and the meditation. And I think there is, because Seth Godin talks about that you can think of status in two ways. And I'm curious what you think about that. And one is affiliation. So basically, you know, who knows you, who trusts you, and where do you stand? And the other one, and which I think is the unhealthy way, and basically is treating status as the end. And I think the status should be treated as means to an end, and the end should be like influence into the right people. He said the second one is dominion. So what can I as an individual do, and who has the most power? So I think that's the, you know, I don't know if you agree with this kind of split, but I think the same thing, you know, I wanted to tie, because you're talking about the self, that, and that's the paradox I think of like self-development, is that it forces you to focus so much on yourself that then you kind of like, you know, the truth is that the more you focus on yourself, the more unhappy you are. At least that's what I found out. and then you, so you kind of like improve, but at the same time, you become more and more like kind of, you know, you hate yourself even more, because I think you make the development as in like the, you know, the end, and it should just be a means to an end. Like the end is in the end to like just do something for, you know, others, I think.
I mean, there's a certain aspect of that, but I can't name one, you know, status ladder or status line and all the stuff that we've talked about where being a good person is proportionally rewarded for the amount of effort that goes into it. And so, in some cases, like I'll look back in the military, some of my bosses, people that attained the rank of, you know, when I was a lieutenant, they were captains. When I was a captain, they were lieutenant colonels or colonels, right? They were or generals. They were higher up the status ladder. Looking at that, I remember being coached by some of them that they would pull me aside as like, Nate, you have to play the game. And I was like, what the game? Like, what was the game? He says, you have to apply for the awards, like officer of the quarter, you know, officer of the year, you know, you got to do community service. You have to do community service and volunteer because that's part of the game that's factored in when you come up for promotion. You need to do well on the inspections. So that's competence related. And this is what pissed me off. You need to show up at the Oak Club. That's the officers club on Thursday nights or whatever it was to go socialize with your fellow officers, with your peers. And I was like, I am not giving up my time at like 6 o'clock at night. I've got like two babies at home, and I'm not going to hang out chit chatting with a bunch of people I don't like. And that actually, like, because it was not useful to them, and sure fuck was not useful to me. So that for me, the challenge, I think that the big problem is, and I agree with Seth Godin. I think that especially in business, that apps, those are the two ways to look at it. And I don't think they're both good or bad, like good or evil, right? I think that for me, to the areas that I want to influence, where I want to leave my legacy, which is typically tied to your meaning. What is my purpose of being on this world? What is my one thing? I could go after all the fortune cookie phrasing from all the books and all of the religions and everything else. Like, what's the meaning? You know, why am I here? That's the thing. We you and I talk a lot about questions. And when you go to that really, really high level question, most people don't know how to answer it. And most people that have been able to answer it aren't brave enough to change their mind if they've maybe gone down the wrong road. So maybe that this was their meaning, and now they've found new meaning. You know, people always say that when you get in a relationship, right, and you start dating someone or you get married, that, oh geez, they're gone now. They're not going into any of the boys' nights out. We're not going to do our fun camping trips anymore. You know, oh, then you throw kids in the mix, you'll never see them again. But the meaning has changed for them, that what they value is now they want to be a good father and a good boyfriend or a good husband and be able to lead the family unit. Of course, realistically, they say that the woman wears the pants in the house. Realistically, the man may hold the status, but the woman holds the influence.
Yeah, because influence is soft power, right?
Mm-hmm.
Basically, like, you know, women had to know how to navigate like the social stuff much better. Mm-hmm. And we were always much better, you know, much better. Like, we were more suited to, like, just exert more, like, physical power, right?
Yeah.
Over other beings. So I think it's part of the, like, the problem now in the like, internet makes it more like in this women game than the men game. And I think
yeah, it seems unfair, right?
Yeah,
until
yeah.
You zoom out and realize that, like, the cards that, like, women weren't allowed to vote. There's people alive right now that are in countries that may not have been able to vote. Like, that just seems absolutely bananas to me. You look at church hierarchies; it's still very prevalent. You know, it's in the Bible. You know, talking about the woman's place, man. Hey, I grew up, like, in the church, and I was raised by a bunch of very noisy, loud, outspoken Jewish women. There weren't any men to be seen. There was no dads around, or if they were there, they were not leading, and they didn't have any status. They held the beta role, and the women all held the alpha role. Right? My grandmother, my mother, and my aunt, like, they were in charge.
Yeah. Oh, talking about the alpha role, or this, and there's also this, I think, idea of, and that's from, let's say, Aaron Claff, about, you know, and it actually, it's very interesting, if, you know, when I listen to his book, you know, seeing it, how effective it can actually be. There's this, and in the whole, like, let's say, relationship game, there's also this aspect of, like, status indicators. So, like, things that you can do, or, you know, at first maybe consciously, later subconsciously,
yep,
to basically show yourself to possibly be higher status than you actually are, or basically just out.
Oh yeah, no, I agree. I totally agree. It's a, I think all of it swirls around the same point, though. Is like, what the fuck do you want? So yeah. As an individual, what do you want? What do you want to do? And in some cases, there are people that are researchers and academics that, as long as they could get their paper read by the right people at the right time, they've forged their legacy and it's done. They can check it off the list. You know, for people like me, and I'm guessing you too, if we do check a big legacy item off the list, we will have another one ready behind it. You know, the struggle, exercising the brain and having some, James Clear talks about in Atomic Habits and in his blog about the Goldilocks principle. You want things to be hard enough. And a lot of high status positions, the reason they're appreciated, because there's some of them are very difficult to attain and very difficult to keep. How do you sell? Look at marketing. We're in the marketing space. How does anyone even agree who number one is? No, it is highly, highly, it's almost tribal. It's like feudal. It's crazy. People get really pissed off if I like speak ill of Russell Brunson. It's like, oh, I want to be just like Russell Brunson. I'm like, okay, that's cool. Or I want to be, I'm more of a Vaynerchuk guy, or more of a Grant Cardone guy, or, you know, I'm more of Seth Godin guy. You could go down the list. I could probably rattle off another 10 to 15. They all have best-selling books, are all accomplished speakers, have all, I think, and arguably made a lot of impact on the world. They've actually helped people with their business, helped people grow wealth, whatever it is. But did they have status? You know, do they have the will to want to stand that top spot? Some of the people that I consider really influential, you don't see in the news anymore. People come in and out of the things. And I think the game that you mentioned earlier, I kind of like that part of it. I enjoy it. That's part of my personality because it challenges me. That's why I'm excited about doing events again. That the social status of a conference, you know, it's like high school. And I was crappy. Of so that social status of high school. So this is my chance to be like, maybe I could be good at it here. And that's super selfish, right? But when I'm in those environments, you know, part of my goal is to get into the cool rooms, to get the to get the backstage pass, to where to get a seat at the table, right? But it doesn't necessarily mean that I want to stay there. I just want to know that I can, because I want to feel, you know, age of you. I want to feel competent. I want to feel badass. I want to feel strong. I want to feel smart. And I want other people to validate that status. That status. Yeah. So, but most people don't know what they want. And that's, I think that's at a very basic level. Who do you want to influence? Or do you want legacy, or do you just want to be able to do things, do big projects and do big things? And in the startup world, do you want to get first dibs on the good funding and the smart money? You know, or do you want to go to, you know, the TechCrunch awards and compete there? It's like the Olympics of startups.
Yeah. Like why do you are doing it? Why do you want the status? Is it the end or is it just means? And do you recognize in the end, like you, I think for you, it's fun because you recognize like sports, it's just a game. Like, you know, we play games in life, and this is like, as long as you don't treat it too seriously, I mean, that's just my opinion.
That's where it ties into meaning, though. Like, my daughter has autism, and a few other mental illnesses. She's gonna have a tough life, right? She's not gonna have high status, right? Now I want to be able to have the influence to pick up the phone and have the top researchers and the top doctors and the top therapists and the top minds in the world take my phone call. And right now I have the skill and competency to do that in my job, but I do not have the status to be able to become a stranger's priority, right? So to take care of her, which is a lifelong thing. I'm our conservator, which means like I'm our guardian for life. It's a lifelong appointment with the court for a long time. Got it all, you know. I'm gonna be her dad forever, you know, until I die. And it's about, I don't possess the status I need, so I've had to learn how academia works. I'm learning that right now, and I'm starting at the very bottom because I barely got a bachelor's degree. I'm not even eligible to like get a master's degree most places. My GPA sucked so hard when I was in college because I just wasn't a good student. So that right now, that lack of competency and that lack of will and attention is hurting me now. And that has nothing to do with me. I just want to take better care of her. Sometimes it's not about my status. Sometimes it means elevating someone else. There's a time for my business partner, Seth, who's a email e-commerce expert. What do I need to elevate him up? Does that mean I need to take a lower spot? And in this case, I did. That's a different conversation for a different day. But now it's too early to tell if that grand experiment worked. It's been a year and a half since we did that. I don't know. So anyways.
Okay. I can end with a question for me, like that we could pick up on it maybe next time we talk is... my thoughts are that is the solution possibly something that Ray Dalio is implemented, and if we were to implement it elsewhere, is idea meritocracy, which is basically let the best idea win no matter who it comes from. And for example, if you look at, like, let's say academia and physics, it should be like the place where it should be, but even that field is susceptible to, you know, like the old guard doesn't want the new idea password this guy. So, you know, and Ray Dalio is a great thinker, and he makes great arguments, and he's proven in his business about this whole concept of idea meritocracy. So, you know, it'd be interesting to explore this, like unpack it of like how, you know, like if that is possibly the antidote to hierarchy.
Or does hierarchy need an antidote?
Yeah, or whether does it even need an antidote?
Yeah. All right, man. I appreciate it, dude. This is fun.